It's the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
Great moments are born from great opportunity.
And that's what you have here.
That's what you've earned here tonight.
Forget about the crowds, the size of the school, their fancy uniforms, and remember what got you here. If you put your effort and concentration into playing to your potential, to be the best that you can be, I don't care what the scoreboard says at the end of the game, in my book, we're going to be winners.
On this team, we tear ourselves and everyone else around us to pieces for that inch. We claw with our fingernails for that inch because we know when we add up all those inches, that's gonna make the f***ing difference between winning and losing.
It's down to the wire with Errol Marks and Speedy Petey.
Oh, Petey!
On the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
And we are back, ladies and gentlemen. This is Down to the Wire. I'm your host, Errol Marks. My co-host, Mr. Speedy Vibrating Petey. Yes, he's in the studio with me, as he always is. As you guys know, our number is to call it, to call the show is 631-965-4990. Remember, go to our website at www.worldwidesportsradio.com. You can search us on all the social medias. If you don't have them, you can look for them. Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, Snapchat. You could find us and listen to our shows on radio.com, TuneIn Radio, and iHeartRadio, and throughout all the podcasts around the country. Speedy, how is your day going? Yesterday, we played a couple of basketball games. And
we did.
And I actually defeated you both games.
You did.
Yes, I did.
Both games by 3 points.
Were you surprised that I actually competed with you?
No, because I'm not as good at NBA, but I was surprised how good defensively you were, because a lot of times you don't have the instincts, or people, when they start playing NBA right away, they try to be all offensive, but you were actually really good defensively, and I was surprised.
Well, you kept passing the ball to anybody that I was defending, and finally, I really got so stressed out and so pissed off, I decided to take Speedy out of the game, and that's what I did. I shut Speedy down at the point guard position, and he had to use his forwards and his center, and he just couldn't do it. And you shot a lot of threes in the second game.
Well, I don't just pass with my point guards either. You just took away the passing lanes, I guess.
Yes, I did.
Because I don't try to pass with one person all the time
either. No, you kept passing on the perimeter. That's right. What you like to do, because you want to have the open three-point shot. But we played video games, and I haven't played video games in a very long time. I played football the other day with him. He whipped my ass. I haven't played football and Madden. My brother gave me the new Madden game. I knew nothing. I don't even know the buttons. I don't know how to switch. I couldn't switch any positions or pick the right plays because I didn't even know where the plays were. So I am not what you call a great Madden football player. But
the playbooks have also gotten worse though over the years too.
But I did compete with you. So I did compete. In basketball, I know the game a little bit better, right. So I competed a lot better against
them. Oh, we used to throw back rosters, which was interesting because both of us didn't know half of our teams.
That's true.
That's funny.
But again, throwback rosters always fun because
it is.
I had Larry Bird in the Celtics with McHale, who absolutely sucked in the game.
He was good in the second quarter, and then he was awful in the second half for whatever reason.
He was terrible.
Robert Parrish was the tough one for me to figure out.
But he only touched the ball maybe 7 or 8 times, but he scored every single
Yeah, he did, because my freaking big men, for whatever reason, they were rated high, but for whatever reason, just got annihilated by him.
Yeah, but we played a couple of video games yesterday, and that's what a lot of people are doing with this COVID-19. They're trying to find things that occupy them to try to stay away from thinking about and being depressed that there's nothing to do, there's nowhere to go, there's nowhere to shop. The only places you could shop is the supermarket or going to the gas station and shopping at 7-Eleven. That's about it. There really is nothing and nowhere to go. So obviously, everybody's trying to find something to occupy themselves, and video games is something that everybody gets into. But I do want to get into this story. And I read a story today on Yahoo about Kevin Garnett. And Kevin Garnett, everybody knows, Tim Duncan, Kevin Garnett, and Kobe Bryant will be inducted to the Hall of Fame eventually this year, whenever it actually goes through. We don't know because of this coronavirus. It usually happens around, I would say it happens around August or September, right?
I think it's in August. I want to say like August 13th or 14th or something like that.
I think it's in August. And Kobe Bryant obviously is going into the Hall of Fame after everything that happened over the last couple of months. Mm-hmm. And Kobe was supposed to be inducted to the Hall of Fame possibly the year after. Mm-hmm. And they pushed it up because of everything that happened to him. So I think it's a great gesture by the NBA.
Which is bizarre because he retired the same year that Duncan did. It was weird.
But I do want to get into this story. Kevin Garnett has spoken out. And everybody knows Kevin Garnett right now does a podcast. He's been doing it for years. If you listen to his podcast, he's very, very funny. Very interactive with the fans. But a story came out actually yesterday that the owner, and I'm trying to get the name right here, the owner of the Timberwolves, if I'm not mistaken, get the owner of the Timberwolves over here. I want to get this whole story. I'm going to read this story to everybody. It's a quick story. It's a good story.
Glenn Taylor?
Glenn Taylor, yes. Kevin Garnett does not seem interested in a jersey retirement with the Timberwolves. Now, obviously, he will be inducted into the Celtics Hall of Fame. His jersey will be lifted up to the rafters next year with the Celtics. Kevin Garnett is a legend of basketball, and his contributions to the game will forever be immortalized in the Basketball Hall of Fame. Garnett is being put in the hall alongside other legends like Kobe Bryant and Tim Duncan. While Garnett won a championship with Boston, he started out his career with the Minnesota Timberwolves. He has had a topsy-turvy relationship with the organization, particularly the owner, Glenn Taylor. In a recent interview with The Athletic, Garnett spoke about how Taylor went against the wishes of himself and Flip Saunders. Garnett is extremely upset at Taylor and says he doesn't want his jersey retired in the city because he doesn't want to work with a snake. Now, the story was coming out with Kevin Garnett that he would sign with the Timberwolves and retire with the Timberwolves if, after he retired, his jersey would be retired and that he would be a part of the organization. He would work alongside certain people, the owners, the GMs, and he'd have a position with the Timberwolves organization, which that did not come true because of the owner, Glenn Taylor. Mm-hmm. Now, Glenn Taylor is a very rich man. He's been a part. He's owned the team for over 50 years, almost 50 years now. And this is a man that over the years, people have complained about around the league. Not about him spending money or him being a good owner. Just the things that have come out of his camp, things that he said about players, and I'm not gonna bring up stories that I don't know. But this is a multi-billionaire that there were stories coming out of Timberwolves land that this man has not only spoken bad about some of the players that he has worked with, but he has spoken bad about legends that he has been part of his organization. Guys like Kevin Garnett, Stephon Marbury. He said something about Tom Thibodeau when he let go of Tom Thibodeau a year ago. This is a man that never holds back on what he says. But the one thing he held back on is the one thing that Kevin Garnett will not stand for, and that's being a snake. When you tell somebody, I want you to come back to my organization. I want you to retire as a Minnesota Timberwolf because you were the main structure of what this organization was when it was an expansion franchise.
He's still the best player by far they've ever had.
And I'm not saying, and everybody says, well, how has he been an owner of the Timberwolves for 50 years when they've been an expansion franchise? He wasn't an owner of the Timberwolves. He's been an owner of professional sports teams for almost 50 years, not just the Timberwolves. Now, I look at the Minnesota Timberwolves as an organization and the way it's been run over the years. Now, is this a good, very well-mannered organization? It isn't.
No.
They brought in Tom Thibodeau, who I believe was a perfect fit for that organization as a coach, not as a coach and GM. But the only way they can pry Tom Thibodeau away from possibly getting a job with the Knicks or wherever he was going to go, because he wanted to be the Knicks head coach, they had to pay him a lot of money and they had to offer him the GM position, which in turn screwed up the organization and eventually came upon guys like Jimmy Butler, who eventually wanted out, was traded away for practically nothing. Now, this organization, which was a very, you know, a year ago, year and a half ago, was supposed to be an up-and-coming organization with guys like Karl Anthony Towns, Anthony Wiggins, Jimmy Butler, Tom Thibodeau, and even, what's his name again, the guy that they drafted, the point guard from the Providence team.
Oh, Chris Dunn.
Yeah, Chris Dunn, who completely failed as an NBA player.
I was wrong on him. I liked him a lot out of that draft.
When you think about what the Timberwolves have done over the years, how about the year that they drafted two point guards in the first round? This is a team that has not drafted right. This is a team that hasn't run an organization right. And it has a lot to do with one person and one person only. Ownership. If everybody wants to blame James Dolan for everything, because that's what it seems like. Everybody wants to blame James Dolan for the screw-up New York Knicks.
So this guy's the lesser talked about James Dolan.
Pretty much.
All right.
So nobody talks about him because he's based out of Minnesota. The organization hasn't won anything, hasn't gone anywhere, hasn't won championships. The best years of this organization's existence was with Kevin Garnett and Stephon Marbury.
And even so, that was a short stint, too.
This organization has not had many superstars. It hasn't. And a guy like Kevin Garnett, at his profiled personality, when you think of Kevin Garnett, you think of his personality. You remember what he said to Carmelo Anthony on the basketball court.
Saying, and in the locker room.
What did he say? He said his wife tasted like Honey Nut Cheerios something like that. Yeah. I mean, his personality has changed the sport of basketball. It really has. Guys like him, Ben Wallace, Rasheed Wallace, guys of those magnitude have changed the game. And now you see players like LeBron James and Harden and Russell Westbrook. These are all characters, but not characters like we saw in the early 2000s. Kevin Garnett changed the game. Just like Kobe did, just like Tim Duncan did. There were three different style of players. Kevin Garnett was a guy that was a great rebounder and had built his perimeter game as the years went by. He was an inside dominance player who was the anchor of the Timberwolves defense. When he went to the Celtics, he became more of an offensive player because then you could spread the offense because you had Ray Allen and had Paul Pierce. His game transitioned the game of leadership, the way he played the game, the eliteness of what he did on the court, changed the game. So did Kobe Bryant with his amazing offensive style of game. His all-around game as a defensive player. His style of game brought the style of Michael Jordan back to the league when Michael Jordan retired. And then there was Tim Duncan, the amazing leader, the guy that led a team to not one, not two, not three, not four, but five world championships.
Maybe the most humble superstar legend you'll ever see.
Was the king of banking the ball. He changed the game. But what changes all three of these players from one another is personality. And as much as Kobe Bryant, people would say Kobe Bryant had an amazing personality, Kevin Garnett was on a whole nother level.
He was fiery and intimidating.
Kevin Garnett was a different person. We know what Tim Duncan was. We know what Kobe Bryant was. His personality was alive and loving, and people and he was the Mamba. Never liked to lose.
He was intimidating in his own right, but Kevin Garnett was another level.
Kevin Garnett took it to another level. And when you hear this story coming out that he doesn't want to wear the jerseys to the Timberwolves jersey to the Hall of Fame. He doesn't want his jersey raised in Minnesota because of the ownership and the organization. That says a lot about an organization that had arguably one of the best power forwards of all time.
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't know if he's going to be able to have control over winning a argument maybe to not put it up, but he's not going to attend any events or alumni stuff that they're going to do from now on.
No, he said he does not want his jersey being lifted.
Mm-hmm. Again, I don't know if he'll be able to do that, though, because, again, he is the best player by far in their franchise history.
If he doesn't go there, what is the point of lifting a jersey? If he doesn't go to the event, why even waste your
time? They might even do it anyway, just because they don't have anything else in that franchise.
I don't know if he's going to be going to anything with that franchise.
No, I'm not saying
soon,
he would.
Unless the owner comes up and actually apologizes what he did to Kevin.
Agreed. I'm just saying they're so desperate to just have that legend just because they're such a young franchise that's been dysfunctional for the most part that they might even do without him.
Charlie, actually, I'm reading what everybody is writing. And by the way, you can write us on Facebook right now because we have a computer that we can actually read what everybody is writing us. So right now, I'm going, there I am. Charlie Rose, top five hardest NCAA college football stadiums to play in.
Wow, that is an interesting question. I mean, most of them, again, correlate with the great teams, I think, for the most part, Charlie. SEC stadiums probably being the most. I think Texas A&M, when they were in the Big 12, was one of the biggest ones, but they haven't been since the SEC. And then if you want like a sleeper one, Boise State's really been tough for a while, too, even though they obviously don't play the same level of competition.
LSU is a hard place to play.
LSU is too, yep.
LSU is a very hard place to play in. I would say the hardest place to play in, and I've heard this from many NFL players over the years, LSU is one of the hardest places to play in because of the crowd, the fans, and really the way the stadium is set up. The roar of the crowd, how the crowd is on top of you. It's a completely different place than a lot of other places. So USC too.
USC, I think they've lost a little bit of it, but yeah.
Because of how bad they've been over the years.
And the Pac-12 as a whole really hasn't had the same firepower with USC and then with Oregon for a while. They really haven't had that same firepower. They're a balanced conference, but they're not really that same powerhouse that they were in the 2000s. So those stadiums, they're probably still up there, but I don't know about top five anymore. You're really looking at a lot of SEC stadiums and Ohio State as well. They're always tough to play. And some of the Big Ten ones are, you can list them there for in crowd environment, but teams like Michigan and Penn State have lost big games there too, though.
And going back, and you heard it from Speedy, you heard it from me. To me, those are the top colleges, what I've heard over the years, hardest places to play in for NFL players. But I didn't even know that about Boise State, by the way. But
they're a very tough one. Again, different scheduling, but they're a very tough environment. I think they've only lost like two home games in the last 10 years or something like that.
But what I really, looking at this story with Kevin Garnett, you could only sit there and laugh as a fan because you think the Knicks are the biggest laughing stock in the NBA, but there are other organizations like the Timberwolves that there is not one Knicks player. There is not one Knicks player that has been invited to being raising their jersey and being retired as an all-time Knicks that has ever said no to James Dolan. There's not one. Not even Charles Oakley, who is never going to be raised in the rafters, because I don't think Charles Oakley, as much as he was my favorite player growing up as a New York Knicks fan because of his rough and ruggedness, I don't think he was good enough to be in the rafters. He wasn't an all-time great Knicks. He wasn't. Anybody that knows the Knicks knows that. But he was a rugged player, and he brought you a personality that New Yorkers could respect.
Plus, it's also a Madison Square Garden. You want to have the greatest of the great up there, not necessarily just – I mean, Oakley was a great player in his own right, but he more of, like you said, a fan favorite. So maybe that has more magnitude to it too. That's why I'm saying with the Timberwolves, they don't really have that kind of mantra. They might be desperate just to get anything up.
Well, as much as you have a mantra – you have Stephon Marbury, who is really the king of China. This guy is the biggest superstar over there in Asia. And you had him for almost 7 years of his career. His greatest part of his career was with the Timberwolves. Why hasn't the ownership reached out to Stephon Marbury and said, listen, we want to retire your jersey in Minnesota? It never happened. It never happened. And now all of a sudden, Kevin Garnett has come out and said that they can say or do whatever they want. I am not going to Minnesota. I do not want my jersey raised up in the rafters. And if they raise it, I will not be there. So saying that and calling the ownership and the organization a snake organization only tells you one thing. If he's not going to do it, what makes you so sure that Stephon Marbury wants to do it? And that's where, who are you going to put? Ricky Rubio up there? Is that what you're going to do? Is that what you're trying to figure out? Come on. What's up, Josh? I see Josh on. Thanks for all the guys tuning in on Facebook and throughout the country on all the different platforms that we are live right now. RTF Sports Radio, thank you for nominating our show Below the Mic, and hopefully we win. We're 2 weeks late, but anybody that wants to vote, please go to RTFSportsNetwork.com. RTFSportsNetwork.com and vote for me and Speedy Petey Below the Mic. Hit vote on the top and hit Below the Mic and vote. You can vote every day. You can vote on all your devices. You can vote on your iPads, your computers, and your phones. So please vote for us. If you're not, RTFSportsNetwork.com. Hit vote for the top show of the month and hit Below the Mic and vote. We'd really appreciate you guys voting for us. But again, back to Kevin Garnett. I look at the NBA as a whole, and I thought that the Knicks are so dysfunctional that players will not go over there and want to be affiliated with the New York Knicks organization, and they wouldn't go over there and get their job. You know how many times, you know how many stories I heard with the Knicks with Patrick Ewing and James Dolan? There were so many stories that came out that Patrick Ewing couldn't stand James Dolan. Couldn't stand him. He never wanted to be traded to the Seattle Supersonics. Never did. It was James Dolan that made them, that forced the GM at the time to rid Patrick Ewing in 1999 after that season.
Did they make the finals without him too? Or
he was a part of that team.
He was part of that team.
He was hurt. Okay. He was hurt. He was playing here and there, but he played in the playoffs, but he was not 100%.
Okay, that's what it was. I wasn't
sure. He was far
sure.
from 100%.
Last Knicks team, then the only 8th seed to make the NBA Finals.
Yes. The crazy thing about this story is it's not the Knicks. It's Minnesota.
Who would have thought?
Who would have thought that not just the New York Knicks, it's the Timberwolves. And there are a lot of dysfunctional teams in the NBA. I mean, Orlando has been a dysfunctional team for years. For years, okay? The L.A. Clippers have been a dysfunctional team for years.
For pretty much their whole franchise history until like probably 09.
New ownership and bringing Doc Rivers in and building a championship and bringing in an owner that understands what it is to keep your mouth shut and let the real smart guys, those real basketball minds, figure things out. But I'll tell you this right now. If I was right now a Minnesota Timberwolves fan, I would write to Kevin Garnett and beg him. I would beg him to come back and be there, even though the ownership is still what it is today, and he doesn't like the ownership in the organization as a whole. If you're a Timberwolves fan and you respect, I see right when I watch Minnesota Timberwolves games on TNT, or I'm watching the Timberwolves on the Sports Network, they're all wearing Garnett jerseys still. Garnett is still a popular player. He really is. And the fact that Kevin Garnett does not want his retired jersey up there in the rafters in Minnesota is a shame. It's a shame for the organization. It's a shame for ownership. It's a shame for the NBA. And not even the one of the worst organizations run, the New York Knicks, have players that say if they were offered to have their jerseys raised in the rafters, even though they hate James Dolan, I guarantee you if Charles Oakley had a phone call from James Dolan or a publicist or the Madison Square Garden that they're going to raise his jersey into the rafters, would not believe that Charles Oakley wouldn't go over there and get his jersey raised in the rafters. Because I absolutely believe Charles Oakley, no matter what he said about the New York Knicks as an organization and as a whole, he would absolutely go there and have his jersey raised.
Yes, you can like the Knicks and not like James Dolan. It's not hard.
So thinking that and seeing that could only tell you one thing. It could only tell you one thing. So that is the problem right now where I see the New York Knicks and what the New York Knicks are. And that's the big problem right now where the Timberwolves are. The Timberwolves are an organization that is a laughingstock. And like I said, if Kevin Garnett is coming out and saying these things about the ownership and the organization as a whole, and that he was promised all these things and were not given those promises when he went and he signed back with the Timberwolves, and then he was sitting on the bench. Remember what the Timberwolves did? They had him sitting on the bench because he wasn't 100%, and then he eventually retired. So the Timberwolves and the ownership got what they wanted. They got Kevin Garnett back, and then they offered him an organizational position, and they didn't give it back to him. They didn't give it to him when he retired. So
that's right. I forgot about his second stint there.
Mm-hmm.
It's weird.
But anyways, we're going to go.
Not surprising.
We're going to go to a quick break. Remember, our number is 631-965-4990. You can call the show. When we come back, we're going to get into some NFL talk, and we're going to get into our NFL AFC and NFC West draft and where we think they are rated in this year's free agency market. Here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
You're listening to the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
Everybody knows who Pearl Jam is. Even Flow, baby. Eddie Vedder. World's greatest singer. I'll tell you, one of the top singers of all time. Rock and roll, alternative rock. Wherever you look at Pearl Jam, you look at Eddie Vedder. Greatest voice. One of the greatest. Him and Freddie Mercury. Unbelievable voice.
Unbelievable.
Yeah. 631-965-4990. We were at break and my nose started bleeding, so I ran to the bathroom and I stuffed a tissue in my nose. We're back live here at the Worldwide Sports Radio Network studios. As you know, Speedy Petey, Errol Marks here live. As you know, worldwidesportsradio.com. You can follow us. Go to all our social medias. If you're not following us on all the social medias, Instagram, Facebook, Snapchat, YouTube, you could find us, Worldwide Sports Radio Network. And our app will be out probably in about a week, I'm hearing. Today I heard a week. So this is big news for us. All the fans out there, all the people that follow us, as you guys know. Josh, who is a good friend and also an analyst and a big-time New York Jet fan, asked me, what did I think about the Jets offseason this year? And we talked about this last week, and I will get into this because you asked that, Josh, and I'm going to give you my whole answer to this. And I look at the Jets as an organization right now. They needed offensive line help, and you knew bringing in Joe Douglas, you knew that was what he was looking at. He was looking at beefing up the front line. Well, he did that this offseason. Good contracts that you can, if they don't work out, you can get rid of next year. That's what I love about these contracts. It's the fact that they weren't 5-6 year deals where they're guaranteeing you $50 or $40 million. What he did is he brought good offensive linemen, not superstar offensive linemen, good offensive linemen, roughneck offensive linemen to help give the Jets that edge at the offensive line.
Versatile offensive linemen too, which is the big key.
Bringing in Font was a good move. The reason why is you plied him away from Seattle. Seattle loved him. The fans loved him. And also, eventually move him at the right tackle position where he would fit perfectly like a glove for the New York Jets for the next 3 years. He's 27 years old. He gives the Jets athletic ability at that position. This is a guy that played tight end in college. So
he played basketball too.
Yes.
He put on, I think, 40 pounds from what he was his rookie year to what he is now.
Yeah, so I like the move with Font. I also love McGovern, who I didn't think the Jets were actually gunning for him, and they brought him in, and I think it was a very, very good move. They got him on a good contract, $18 million guaranteed. I think it was around 30.
3 years, 27.
Yeah, almost $30 million. I like the move by the Jets. If he doesn't pan out, you get rid of him. But now you bring in an eligible top 7, top 8 center that can help Sam Darnold develop. Give them that opportunity to grow as one. And that's what I love about what the Jets are doing right now. Then they bring in Von Rotten, who everybody says, well, who the hell is he? He's a guy that played for the Carolina Panthers over the years. He's a guy that nobody even talks about. Now, is he a starting offense? We don't know where these guys are going to fit on this offensive line because we don't even know if the Jets are done. We don't know if the Jets decide to draft a left tackle in the first round or a left tackle in the second round. We don't know where they're going to go with that. That's why this makes these acquisitions even more interesting, because they didn't bring in just two offensive linemen. They brought in four. And they still have Harrison there. And they still have Brian Winters there. So they're stocked, and you have to stock at those positions because those positions are not guaranteed for people to stay healthy. I'll tell you this right now. Everybody could say, and I don't care what Jeff says, because Jeff called up yesterday and he said his stupid garbage stuff that he always says. And he has nothing good to say about the New York Jets and what the New York Jets do or say or even give a crap about. The Jets made quality moves for quality players and didn't overpay guys like Robbie Anderson. That's what the Jets did. They brought Perriman in because he's the same type of player as Robbie Anderson. He's just cheaper, and you only signed him for 1 year. You can get rid of him after next year and bring in a top wide receiver if he becomes available. You don't have to overpay a wide receiver, a veteran wide receiver. You get a guy almost the same age as Robbie Anderson that could do the same things and probably even more versatile.
He's more versatile. His hands are probably slightly better. He's had drop problems too, so it's not like it's
every
great by any
wide receiver except Larry Fitzgerald or Julio Jones.
Well, okay, but again, you're judging elite receivers. I'm saying he's had a history of drop problems at times, as has Anderson. But again, they're slightly better. And
but we're not talking about elite receivers.
No, I know that. I'm just saying production wise is where Perriman's a lot better too. When he got the opportunity, he was a lot more consistent in that.
Can't say healthy.
Well, of course. I'm just saying when he got the opportunity, he was a little more consistent. When he was with Cleveland, he had to, again, get up the depth chart. But when he did play in the second half of the season, he was very good. And last year at Tampa, he was a third receiver, but he was a consistent third receiver.
The whole goal this offseason was to protect Sam Darnold. Make sure you protect the franchise. That's what he did. He found guys to protect the guy that they believe is the franchise of this organization moving forward. Now, the question is, did he pick the right guys? Only time will tell. And if he didn't pick the right guys, they will be gone next year because they only gave him certain contracts that are only affordable for really 1 or 2 year contracts, and you can get rid of the third year. If Font doesn't really work out for them this year, they only gave him $16 million guarantee. They could get rid of him. It doesn't really hurt their salary cap. What does it hurt them? $5-6 million? Mm-hmm. It doesn't really hurt their salary cap to get rid of him. So in the thought, these were quality moves from a guy that is new to the position who learned through arguably two or maybe even three of the best GMs in professional football. So I look at what the Jets have done. They've done the right thing. Now, the question is, are these guys the right players and the right fit and the right structure of this team? McGovern thinks that the Jets are moving in a really special way, and he thinks that this team is going to be a Super Bowl contender. But everybody says that. When the Jets signed Tremaine Johnson, every Jet fan was happy about that. Every one of us was happy about Tremaine Johnson because Tremaine Johnson's a good player.
And he was improving year to year, too, so it was surprising. But again, he still only had two good seasons, so it could have been a trap. And it obviously was.
So my opinion of what the Jets did, I'd rate them a B minus this offseason. It could move up to a B+ or an A-, depending on how the players really fit and where the players go going forward with Sam Darnold. Sam Darnold is the key here. If they work very well with Sam and they protect Sam and they give Sam 3 to 4 seconds, Sam will be a star quarterback in this league. He will be. So that's my opinion about the Jets. They weren't blockbuster moves. Are you mad about Jack Conklin? Nah. Not really. I wasn't really upset that the Jets didn't bring in Jack Conklin. They could have gotten, they gave Font $10 million or $11 million a year. They could have given Conklin $14 million a year and got Conklin. Is he a better player than Font? Yeah, absolutely. Yes. But maybe Conklin didn't want to come to the Jets. How do we know?
Yeah, maybe Conklin wanted extra to come to the Jets. Depends on the circumstances. There's no guarantee that just because they match the Browns offer, they're going to get it. Other teams have a certain incentives for different reasons depending on the player.
And Josh also says, also thoughts on Keandre Miller situation. Does this put the NHL in a bad spot? Well, what is the story about Keandre Miller?
There was some virtual conversation.
I didn't hear about this.
Yeah, the Keandre Miller was a victim of racial slurs.
Really?
I don't know between who. I'm looking that up now. But again, there are a lot of players obviously coming to his defense because of this.
Really? I didn't hear about that. I mean, we've heard this over and over again about, and not just NFL players or basketball players or hockey players or football players. If anybody remembers the story, I don't know if anybody remembers. John Van Beesbrook is my favorite player growing up. Everybody knows him, the Beezer.
Oh, it was a hacker. That's what it was. Okay. So a hacker got into one of the video feeds of the NHL officials, I guess, and he was using racial language towards Keandre Miller.
Very, very interesting. So Van Beesbrook owned, I guess you could say, an OHL team, St. Mary's in Michigan, when he retired. And he was the GM and the owner of the organization. He had an African-American on his team. And he was upset because that particular player was not doing what he wanted him to do on the ice when he came down to speak to him. He spit out racial slurs, which then cost Van Beesbrook to sell his team and walk away from his franchise. And probably cost Van Beesbrook any chance of going to the Hall of Fame. And Van Beesbrook, and I'll tell you this straight out, I would never bring this up to John Van Beesbrook. Never bring this up. When I've interviewed John, I would never bring this up. But I know in John's heart, if that never happened, John Van Beesbrook would be a Hall of Famer. It ruined any chance. America's winningest goaltender of all time. John Van Beesbrook has more wins than any American goalie in history. In history. Now, everybody just wins. He has one of the best goals against out of American goaltending in the 80s and the 90s and the 2000s.
He moved around a lot of different teams, too.
The fact is, when you spit out racial slurs and you attack somebody with racial slurs, it's a big no-no. It is a big no-no. In professional sports, I don't care who you are. I don't care if you're Chinese, white, African-American, or anything. I don't care what team. I don't care if you hate the Rangers and you hate Keandre Miller. You do not spit out racial slurs. And maybe it's a social media thing. Maybe these people just want to be the center of attention and using racial slurs will draw them attention. That's why we shouldn't be giving them attention for this. Mm-hmm. But this is something that's sad because this is the way professional sports is. And where it leads to could be death threats. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's ridiculous. Sports is supposed to be fun. Sports is something to take us away from our lives. That's why we watch sports. That's why we talk sports. It's to take our boring lives or our family life. And I'm not saying your family lives are boring. You have kids. Great. Grand. Happy for you guys.
Right. And again, it's also just a person issue. It's not really a league issue because it happens in all sports and it happens with all different type of people. You had those Red Sox fans that were saying racist things at Adam Jones. The Patriots fans were saying racist things at Tyreek Hill. It's all just crazy people. It's not a supplement of the league because, especially with hockey, with all the different ethnic groups and countries where players are born in and coaches and stuff like that. So we know they're not going to be involved in it. And again, the story was it's a hacker that went into that system. So it's just a crazy person. It's a guy that has nothing better to do with his life. So he says derogatory things.
Well, again, we don't know who the hacker is. It could be somebody in the league that we don't know. There are people that are very good with computers and maybe they had their own thoughts to whatever they have their thoughts.
I mean, it's possible, but again, I feel like it's just going to be more of
whatever. I just want to,
because again, especially with what's going on right now, it gives these people that have this weird knowledge
and know how to hack stuff, more incentive to be able to do that.
I just want to apologize to all the Instagram fans. I know me and Speedy are on one feed, and he's backwards on one feed, and I'm frontwards, and he's backwards. I'm backwards on one feed, and he's frontwards. I'll figure that out. This is the first time we're actually using the Instagram feed on dual camera scope, so I'll figure that out. We'll fix it, and it won't look like this the next time we are live. Last thing, Jets and Clowney.
You're going to make Errol mad, Joshua.
Keep on it. Josh, I'm gonna be honest with you here. And everybody knows I'm a Jet fan, and I'm an honest Jet fan. I want to stay far, 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 far away from Jadeveon Clowney. I do not want Jadeveon Clowney. I don't care
if his price falls.
If you can get Jadeveon Clowney for $10 million, I'll take him. $10 million, I take him. Any more than that, I don't want Jadeveon Clowney. Jadeveon Clowney, to me, go look at what he did last year on a Seattle team that was a pretty good defensive team. They were a pretty good team. They weren't great, but they were pretty good. Go look what he did. He had three sacks. Three sacks on a pretty good defensive team. This is a guy that's supposed to, he wants elite money. He wants $17, $18 million a year. You think the Jets should give him $17, $18 million a year when they gave C.J. Mosley all that money last year? And C.J. Mosley couldn't stay on the field, and he's a way better player. A way better player than Jadeveon Clowney.
But it's also more premier position, though.
That's fine. I don't want a premier play. I don't want a premier position with a player that I don't know could play that position for the money that he wants. That's the problem. Jadeveon Clowney was supposed to be a top superstar in this league. He was supposed to be one of the best players at his position in the league when he was drafted. He was the number one pick.
Oh, yeah, we know that, but you can't judge the hype versus what he currently is, though.
Well, what he currently is, we know he's not going to match
that hype, but he's still a productive player. He's still a well-rounded,
athletic player. So you're going to take a productive player and pay him $17 million. Oh, he's productive. I'll give him $17 million.
He's well-rounded.
He's not well-rounded. Yes, he's not a good pass rusher. He's highly overrated at the pass rushing position. He's got 32 sacks in six seasons. You think that's good?
In six seasons for when he hasn't been healthy? Yeah. I mean, he's not playing 16 games a year.
It doesn't matter. He has 32 sacks in six seasons, or five and a half seasons. Is that good? Does anybody think that's good for a pass rusher that wants $17, $16 million a year, or more than that?
But it's also, again, him being able to move around. It's also run defense. It's a lot of different things. It's also his size and age, too. That's why he's going to want it. Will he get it? I don't know.
Maybe he's not getting it because he's not been signed yet.
Right. Maybe his injuries are too much for teams right now, so that might drop his price. But that doesn't mean on the field he doesn't perform. He got off to a slow start with the Seahawks, and again, that just didn't work for him.
Hold on. Stop making excuses for Jadeveon Clowney, because Jadeveon Clowney, every time you read the stories about Jadeveon Clowney, he thinks he's the best pass rusher in the league. We know he's not, but he thinks he is. So if he thinks he is, tell me, Jadeveon, if you're one of the best pass rushers in the league, why did you just have three sacks last year on a Seattle team? Oh, and by the way, you played almost 16 games. So you played almost 16 games and had three sacks. You didn't even average a sack every five games. What does that tell you? It tells you you're not as good as you think you are. And as a Jet fan, I do not want to bring in a washed up, know-it-all player that thinks he's going to fit with our organization when we know he's not. Did Muhammad Wilkerson do that? Muhammad Wilkerson had one of the best pass rushing years we've seen a pass rusher for the Jets have since John Abraham. The Jets gave him $86 million. And what happened? What happened? He was a bust. They gave him the $86 million. He wasn't ever 100%. And he winded up a year and a half later being dealt by dropping him. They dropped his contract. He went to Green Bay, and then he was hurt again. He missed the whole season, and he's probably done with the NFL. He got his money.
Didn't he have off-field issues, though, after that contract?
Yeah, I think it was drinking.
Yeah, something like that.
And then he wanted to sue Manish Mehta, something like that, and the Daily Post. Oh,
the same Manish Mehta that hasn't called your show yet.
Well, Manish Mehta has been on our show before.
No, it seems like he's been pending guest for like 6 months now.
Well, the whole thing with Manish is he's always busy. But right now, if you reached out Manish Mehta, we can get Manish Mehta on the show. I guarantee you we can get Manish Mehta on the show. But Do we want Manish Mehta on the show right now?
That's your call.
So we'll see. We'll absolutely see. But let's get into it, Speedy. We're going to get into the NFC and AFC West right now. Where do we see these teams now with free agency? And where do we see them in the draft? All Speedy
right.
first.
All right, we'll start with the Arizona Cardinals in the NFC West. Another team I think that had a very good offseason so far. They were the beneficiary of a dumb trade the Texans made. They bring in DeAndre Hopkins, who arguably is the most skilled receiver in football right now, or if not, he's top three. They only give up a second-round pick and a fourth-round pick next year, and a guy they were trying to get rid of anyway in David Johnson, who got paid $13 million a year. And also they shore up the defense. A lot of the moves on defense are nice. Devondre Campbell, 1 year, $8.5 million, a guy that has good speed and can cover, good man coverage guy. Devon Kennard, good versatile speed rusher. I don't know what type of defense they're trying to play. Vance Joseph has played hybrids in Miami and Denver in the past, so I don't know. And Jordan Phillips, a nose tackle type, nice 3 year deal. He did not pay much. I think it was only $5 million a year. So I think a nice offseason for Arizona so far.
Offensive line help is the number one priority that they need.
Absolutely. That's still the one area they have not addressed yet. You have to
take Where are they drafting?
They're number eight. They have to take a tackle.
They're going to get a tackle.
No matter who it is, whether it's Andrew Thomas, whether it's Tristan Wirfs, or Mekhi Becton, the kid from Louisville, they have to make sure they get one of those guys, even if it means trading up a little bit to try to steal them maybe from a Carolina Panthers that might need one, or the Chargers if they don't take a quarterback. If that means trading up a little to do it, do it. You have the extra draft stock now to be able to work with that. Make sure you have to get a tackle, because that line is really bad right now. And the rest of the team is not bad right now. They have running back, they have receiver, they have some good pieces on defense, so they really just need to get off.
Well, they stole a receiver.
Yeah, they did.
They stole a receiver.
They absolutely did. So yeah, that's Arizona. I think they've had a very good offseason so far. Let's go now to the Seattle Seahawks. A lot of small moves like we usually see from the Seahawks. They're a team very much like the Patriots. They don't really like to make a lot of big, splashy moves. They did in 2013 with the two pass rushers, Averill and Bennett, but beyond that...
We got a question before you go back.
Go ahead.
Niffin says, do you think there will be any surprise trades at the draft?
Surprise trades? That is interesting. You could definitely see... Like I said, I think Jacksonville and Carolina are both interesting wild cards. You could definitely see them both trade up and trade back. And again, it wouldn't surprise me that if they trade up for something that isn't a quarterback. Niffin, a month ago, I would have said Atlanta, and I wrote an article on that. Atlanta trying to trade up all in for Chase Young. But now with all they purged, I don't know if they can do that anymore. But again, don't be surprised if a team does that. All in for a player like Young or Simmons. It might not be for a quarterback. And I think, again, the teams to watch for that would be Jacksonville or Carolina for me, if I were to judge that. Maybe the Raiders, they do a lot of crazy things, so I don't know. Those would be the three to watch out for.
I would definitely look at Oakland. I mean, you've been hearing stories about Derek Carr. I don't know if they're 110% sold on Derek Carr, so maybe there'll be a surprise trade. I can absolutely see the New England Patriots make a trade for Derek Carr. And I could see John Gruden and Bill Belichick doing that. Derek Carr would fit perfectly in that offense. He really would. I don't know if the Raiders really, really love Derek Carr as their future quarterback. Now, the contract works fairly for their salary cap and where they plan this team to be going to Vegas, but you just never know. I mean, you heard stories about Vegas probably going after Tom Brady, but $30 million a year was too much for them to handle. So watch out for Oakland. I could see Oakland making a trade, maybe trading Derek Carr. There are a couple of teams. I mean, you could go back and forth on who. Baltimore can make trades. Baltimore's going to try to move up because Baltimore believes that they're going to be a Super Bowl contender. They need to fill in certain spots that can make them a top organization, a top team, or another top team that they were last year. I think that they're a fairly good team, so I think that there are other positions that they need to fill in. And if they think that there's a player that could be a game changer, watch Baltimore and Jaguars, especially the Jaguars.
They could do anything.
The Jaguars could do anything, so watch out for the Jaguars still.
All right, so Seattle for me, again, they've done a lot of small moves. They're a lot like the Patriots, where they don't make a lot of huge moves. Jaron Reed, we're bringing him back. Very underrated interior defensive lineman, 2 years, $23 million. I think the only reason it wasn't longer in terms of the length of the contract was because of the suspension he had last year for his, I think it was some drug issue that he had.
Was it you? Were you the drugs?
I am not the drugs, no.
Well, you look like a drug.
Of course you think
the ladies think that you are a drug.
Sure, we'll go with that. But again, everything else really just small moves. Greg Olsen, not a bad gamble. I mean, if you can get anywhere, you could get maybe even him playing just more than half the season at this point. It's going to be a good move. I think he's a better fit than Jimmy Graham ever was there. Better blocker. And again, good just a security blanket type guy. BJ Finney, not a bad versatile lineman either. But again, everything else really is just small moves. In terms of the draft, they tend to like to trade back all the time, so it wouldn't surprise me if they did that again. They're going to have to keep addressing defense. I think they still need some help in that secondary and pass rush as well. Now, again, they're the team, unless they bring him back, losing Clowney. And Ziggy Ansah so far has been a bust as a pass rusher. He really didn't even play much for them at all. So they have a lot of big pass rush holes. Offensive line's been a big hole in secondary. I think that's where they're going to go in. Receiver's was a big hole for a while for them, but I think that's a little more shored up. Yeah, they had a better year from Lockett, a good year from Metcalf for the most part. So I think their offensive skill players for once are actually okay. So offensive line, D-line, and secondary is where I would focus in the draft if I'm the Seahawks. And again, there's a lot of good corner depth, a lot of good back-end safety depth where they can find late first, early second, especially if they do trade back. The Niners, okay, they traded DeForest Buckner, which, again, I like that trade for both teams. I think the Niners got the 13th pick in the draft, and I think they did that to get something they need a little more, whether it's a receiver, whether it is a corner. They did it for something they're going to need more, because they have enough pass rush depth as it is. Their defensive line is still very good. Even some of the rotational guys are very good on that team. So I think that's why they did it. I feel like they're going to try to get a receiver at that pick, maybe even trade up. Or if CeeDee Lamb or somebody like that falls, they're going to end up with one of those guys. I think that's why they did it. Or a corner. Maybe they trade up for somebody like Okuda. If he falls, again, maybe they could draft somebody like a CJ Henderson or a Christian Fulton. Because those are the two biggest needs, really. But I think that's why they did it. And they have another pick to do that. So maybe they trade the two ones and even go up even further in the draft. So I like that move for both teams, even though I think Buckner's a really good player. Armstead, 5 years, $85 million. I think they overpaid for him a little bit. I like him as a player. He's a versatile guy who can play both inside and outside on the defensive line. Good power rusher. $21 million and $21 million a year and 48.5, maybe a little much though. And especially when they have to pay other guys coming up, they're a very young team. That could make it harder, especially with the contract already for Garoppolo. Small moves beyond that. Ben Garland, 1 year, $2.25 million. He was a center with Atlanta when Shanahan was there. I think that's why they did it. And Travis Benjamin, same kind of thing as what they already have. Just a bunch of small speed receivers that can also be running backs. In the draft, like I said earlier, receiver and corner, I think, is really the areas they're going to look in. If CeeDee Lamb somehow falls to 13, don't be surprised if that's where they're picking. Maybe interior offensive line as well. But otherwise, I think it's really going to be receivers and corners at the deep corner draft. You've heard me list the guys already for how deep it is. So that's the Niners. And lastly, the LA Rams. They don't have much to work with at all, whether it comes to cap space or draft picks. So they need a lot. And it's because they've spent a lot of money in certain player areas, and they haven't been able to create holes. I like the move for Leonard Floyd. 1 year, $10 million. Kind of a prove-it deal for him. He had a down year last year, but still is a good young pass rusher. Could be a good hybrid and outside linebacker type. A'shaun Robinson. Kind of a weird fit for the Rams, but again, he's a good pass rushing type defensive tackle. They bring back Michael Brockers, and they re-sign Andrew Whitworth, which is key too. 3 years though, which is surprising for somebody I think 37 years old.
Well, they signed him for 3 years, but he's not staying with them for 3 years. Probably stay there for another year. If he has a good season, he'll stay there for another year. But if he has a bad year, he'll be done.
All right, so the Rams, again, draft pick wise, they're not going to be able to do much. I think they have 2/3. I think that's the first spot they pick in the draft because they traded for
the first.
By the
way, that Leonard Floyd move was a great move.
I like that move too. Back end of the draft, I mean, you have to hope maybe that there's some good interior offensive linemen, because again, their tackles aren't terrible. Again, Whitworth's really good, and Rob Havenstein, when he's healthy, is not bad either. But again, the interior is where it's a big issue for them, and we've seen the Rams offense get exposed pretty badly. When you can pass rush them from the interior, it's not the same.
So I don't think they care about that, Speedy. Just go into why and what they need to do to make them a better team. That's it.
So interior line, I think, and linebacker is the other one. They lost Corey Littleton, and their run defense has still been really bad. Their secondary is okay. They could probably live with it for now in terms of their safeties, but the linebackers are definitely where they're going to have to help. So they're going to have to hope to find gems.
So you got them?
Yep.
All right. Who do we have first?
Arizona.
The Arizona Cardinals. You know, it's interesting. Speedy was mentioning, well, what did they do this offseason? The biggest acquisition, I believe, this offseason in the NFL, besides Tom Brady, was the trade of DeAndre Hopkins. David Johnson going over there to the Texans, and DeAndre Hopkins going to the Arizona Cardinals, giving Kyler Murray a weapon that he's never had, a weapon who I believe could be the best wide receiver in football right now when healthy. And in the prime of his career, I think it was a terrible trade. I think the Texans will regret getting rid of DeAndre Hopkins. But it was a good move. Bringing back Kenyon Drake, who I believe was one of the best running backs in the second half of the season, going to Cardinals. I really think he fits that offense. He fits that mold. They need to have offensive line help. That's what they need. That's been their weakness. So that's where I think they go. Devin Kennard is a good player, good linebacker, not a great linebacker. We'll see what he does with that three-year deal. I think it was a value contract. We'll see what he is. But that's what I think about the Cardinals. The next team.
Oh, you want to do the draft for the Cardinals?
No, I just said they need offensive line help. I don't go over and over again with what you do, okay. Speed.
All right, so Seattle.
You take too long and you go into too much depth. We're trying to get through this. It takes up the whole show. The Seattle Seahawks. Philip Dorsett, wide receiver from the New England Patriots. Nothing big. Will he fit with Russell Wilson? He does fit the Russell Wilson mold, the small, fast wide receiver. Could he blossom with Russell Wilson? Absolutely. We'll see what he does with Seattle's offense. Seattle's offense has been very, very multiple dimensional over the years. Bruce Irvin, expected to sign with the Seattle Seahawks. Bruce Irvin, his best part of his career was with Seattle when he was drafted. Maybe it really elevates him. But the big acquisition this offseason was Greg Olsen. I think he's going to be a steal right now. One-year deal. I don't know why Carolina didn't bring him back. He's been one of the best tight ends in football for the last, I don't know, 5-6 years. Can't stay healthy. He's had problems. But if he stays healthy, even though Seattle does not, and Russell Wilson over the years has not really thrown the ball very well against two tight ends or top tight ends, Greg Olsen, I think, is a different player than Jimmy Graham. So I like that move. As far as what Seattle needs to do, pass rush, pass rush, pass rush. This is what they've been lacking the last couple of years. They bring in Jadeveon Clowney. Jadeveon Clowney did not do the job. He's no longer going to fit with Seattle. That's why Seattle is not going to re-sign him unless they get him on the cheap. So that's where I think they should go. Next team.
Right there, the Niners.
The Niners? I think the Niners made some mistakes this offseason. Not bringing Bruckner back didn't make any sense. I understand they brought in a first-round draft pick out of that. But you don't know what that first-round draft pick is going to translate into. So you know what Bruckner is. You know what this team... Buckner, right?
DeForest Buckner, yeah.
Buckner. I said Bruckner. Buckner... I think Buckner fit very, very well in this defense because Joey Bosa coming to this team changed the defense, changed the defensive line for the better. I think this was one of the best defensive line, if not the best defensive line in football last year. Why would you get rid of that when it took you all the way to the Super Bowl? It made no sense. But they decided to go that way, and Travis Benjamin is just another fill-in position. They really didn't do anything this offseason that really stood out. As far as the draft is concerned, wide receiver is the important position they need to look for. They went after Emmanuel Sanders. They gave up a lot of draft stock because of him. He really didn't do what he was supposed to do in the Super Bowl or in the NFC title game. So I think that was a bad trade. So that's where I think they need to go. Wide receiver is the most important position for them. And what do we got right now?
The Rams.
The Rams. The big acquisition they made was Leonard Floyd. I think he's a good edge rusher. I was very surprised Chicago let him go. This guy was drafted 2 or 3 years ago. I do believe he has elite talent in the right scheme. Wade Phillips is no longer there. It might hurt his development. Andrew Whitworth, very interesting move, bringing him back for 3 years. The only way he was going to go back to the Rams is if he got this contract. Even though this contract, $12.5 million guaranteed, they can get rid of that contract after next year if he really isn't the player they think he is. Where do they go? Offensive line. This is what this team needs. Andrew Whitworth is not getting any younger. Bring in an offensive lineman, a left tackle, a right tackle that you can transition to a left tackle if he's a right tackle in the league for the next couple of years. So that's the big position I think the Rams need to go after.
All right. So now we're on the AFC West. We'll start with the Chargers because they're right here. I think the Chargers have quietly had a very good offseason. They bring in Chris Harris.
a nice contract, 2 years, $17 million, not overly expensive. That's very good for what is still a number one corner in this league. I mean, it's not a big need for the Chargers, but definitely will help guys like Desmond King and Trevor Williams and guys like that actually play in their natural positions. And him and Casey Hayward might be the best tandem in the league right now if you're looking at a corner duo. Brian Bulaga, again, injury-prone offensive lineman, but still a good offensive lineman when he's healthy. Nice move for them. They need tackles badly. I love the trade they made for Trey Turner. They dealt Okrumu, really wasn't playing well there. And he's a lot younger. I think Trey Turner's 26, and he's a faster guard, and I think that'll help them a lot for what is potentially a more mobile type offense. Linval Joseph, a great move again. 2 years, $17 million. They've lacked run defense for years, and they haven't had that type of nose tackle type, defensive tackle type, since Jamal Williams was there, and he was one of the better ones in the league. And then they lose Melvin Gordon, but they keep Austin Ekeler. Again, we'll see if he's the full-time guy. They might draft another running back to complement him. We'll see on that. In terms of the draft, they're picking early. Do they go quarterback? I would consider it. If they don't bring in somebody like Cam Newton, I think you have to consider it, whether it's Justin Herbert, whether it's Burrow. If the Bengals surprise everybody and take Herbert, they got to take a quarterback. If they don't want to take a quarterback, they could go offensive line again. They could go linebacker. If they want to trade up for somebody like Isaiah Simmons, that could be definitely something interesting for the Chargers. There's a lot of areas they can go in, and if they don't sign a quarterback, that'll make it a lot more interesting too, because they could definitely add one. We'll go to the Raiders now. The Raiders have been active. A lot of minor moves, really, but again, they've had some good moves too. Corey Littleton is a great move for them. 3 years, $36 million. Good man coverage linebacker. Fast to the outside. And the Raiders need that. They have corner issues right now, so something that can help them is a good coverage linebacker like that. A lot of former Cowboys. Malik Collins, 1 year, $6 million. Not terrible, not great. Jeff Heath, not crazy about it, but it's depth. Carl Nassib, 3 years, $25 million, not bad either. And then they bring in Marcus Mariota. It's good insurance policy for Carr. Good backup quarterback. 2 years, $17.6 million, not overly expensive. That's not bad at all. In terms of the draft, the Raiders have two first-round picks. One, I think, is 12, and I think the other is 19. A lot of areas they can go in. I think receiver and corner are the two biggest ones, kind of like I was saying with the Niner, because they traded Gary and Conley to the Texans for whatever reason last year. Trayvon Mullen was decent in the second half of the year, but they still need corners badly. And don't be surprised if they take two corners in the first round, too. They take somebody like Henderson, they take Fulton at 19, and double up on that position, because their pass rush did all right last year. Their run defense was actually surprisingly good last year. So focus on that area if you want to go defense. And then offensively, I think receiver would be where they would have to go if they want to take somebody there. If, again, somebody like CeeDee Lamb falls at 12, it's a possibility they could do that, too. The Chiefs, the Super Bowl champion Kansas City Chiefs. Again, they had barely any salary cap to work with. I think at one point they had like less than $200. So they really didn't have to do much. Chris Jones, they franchise tagged. I don't think they'll be able to sign him to a long-term deal, so we'll see if they trade him. Damian Williams, they just picked up the contract for. So again, they didn't really do much. In terms of the draft for them, they're picking late. Running back could be an option for them. Maybe somebody like Clyde Edwards-Helaire or Jonathan Taylor at 32, depending on who falls there. If not, they could do that in the second round. Interior defensive line, if they do end up trading Jones especially, will be key for them. And linebacker, because they have a lot of holes at that position, especially losing Reggie Ragland, who signed with the Detroit Lions. So the Chiefs have options there, but the rest of their team is pretty good beyond that. And then the Broncos, another team I think that has had a very good offseason so far. Great trade for A.J. Boye, I think, only dealing a fourth-round pick. He could be a good veteran corner to help out that young secondary right now. They bring in Jarrell Casey, which I think is a fantastic move for just a seventh-round pick. They've needed that kind of front three presence on that defensive line for a while. They've had outside rushers over the years. They really haven't had the interior guys, and Casey's the best they have. Glasgow, a nice move, and Melvin Gordon, a really nice move. Only 2 years, $16 million. In terms of the draft, I think the Broncos, there's a lot of directions they could go in. They could go offensive line if somebody falls to 15. They could go corner. They could go receiver. There's a lot of areas. They could go interior. Maybe they trade up for somebody like Derek Brown, who's a versatile guy, who's a really good athlete, and he could play both inside and outside on that defensive line. There's a lot of areas the Broncos would go in, but they're building, rebuilding very nicely, quietly, but very nicely.
All right, Speedy. Let me go through this pretty quick.
We got the Chargers.
Well, here's the problem. They don't have a quarterback. That's something that they really need to start looking for in this year's draft. Is it Tua? Is it Herbert? it could be either or. It could be Jordan Love. It could be one of these guys. They're going to need that type of guy to fill in big shoes in Phillip Rivers, who's no longer there. Bring in a Bulga, Brian Bulga, who is a very good offensive lineman. For all these years, the offensive tackle protecting Aaron Rodgers all those years. This is a guy that can't stay healthy. When he is healthy, he has been a very good offensive lineman. I wouldn't say elite style, but amongst the top 10. I would say he's 10 or 9. He's been a very good offensive tackle, so that was a pretty good move. Austin Eckler, bringing him back. You have to bring him back. He's had a sensational year. He's going to be your number one guy now moving forward. So he is very, very important. Linville Joseph, who I met at the in Miami, very, very nice guy. And we are going to get him on the show in the next couple of weeks. I really like to get him on the show. He agreed to a two-year, $17 million contract, $19 million with incentives, which is very, very good for him. I think that was a great pickup for him. A big guy, a guy that can clog up the middle and get to the quarterback, fits very, very well in that defense. And Trey Turner, a good move. We'll see what he is when you acquire a player like that from a team of the Carolina Panthers. He's a quality player. We have to see what he does on this line, a line that has not been good over the years. What they need to do, offensive line, and quarterback. That's what they need. I would go after as many offensive lines that you can. This defense has been very, very good. They lost their starting safety, Derwin James, for a significant amount of time last year. Having him the whole season will be key for their defense to move forward. King took a step back last year. He needs to take a step forward. But I think the Los Angeles Chargers need to go after an offensive lineman or offensive linemen and a quarterback. That's where I think they need to go. The Raiders, I like the Nelson Aguilar signing. One-year deal was worth it. What did they pay him, $1 million?
I mean, it says $1,047,500.
That's a pretty good deal for a wide receiver that was really Carson Wentz's number one target for like 3 years. I mean, he's been a very impressive wide receiver when he's on the field. The question is, he needs to stay on the field. So 1 year, $1 million is a pretty good deal in my eyes for the Raiders. Jeff Heath, a good player, not a great player. A safety that could fill in certain spots. Getting him for $8 million is an affordable player. Marcus Mariota was a steal for a backup quarterback. You're going to need a backup quarterback for Derek Carr, especially if you decide to trade Derek Carr and bring in a rookie. So that's going to be something that you're going to have to look at the draft. I could see that happening. And Jason Witten. Jason Witten is an old man who can help the young quarterback out, or the few, maybe Derek Carr. He give him a kind of like a blanket for the new season. So, and they have a star wide receiver tight end in
Darren Waller.
So we'll see how he does his second year with the Oakland Raiders. Where do I think Oakland need to go? That's a good question. I think they still need wide receiving help. They don't need a running back. They have a star running back. Offensive line. You never have enough offensive linemen. This was one of the best offensive lines in football last year, but also early in the season they had offensive line injuries.
Tons of them. Yeah.
Yeah. So they need to stay healthy. They need to, if there's
one of the tackles falls,
a tackle there. But I think they're drafting wide receiver. In the draft, I do. I think they're going to go after a star wide receiver. Depending on who's there, a Lamb's there, a Judy's there, they're going to draft him or Rupp. They're going to get one of those guys. I think they need that guy.
Are you afraid of them leapfrogging the Jets possibly to steal one?
No, not at all.
I trust
Joe Douglas. Okay. I trust Joe Douglas knows what he's doing. Up next, that's where I think they are. Who do we have? Kansas City?
Kansas City.
Kansas City really didn't have to make any acquisitions or moves. This is a team that was a Super Bowl champion last year. They brought back Chris Jones in a franchise tag. They might trade him. They might keep him and see what they could do this year. They could go back-to-back years with a championship. This team is still good enough to win. Antonio Hamilton is a good player, not a great player. He's a fill-in player. There was nothing that was that impressive in my eyes where I think Kansas City made acquisitions this offseason, except bringing Chris Jones back and not trading him right away. Try to get as much stock as you can for him. But where do they go in the draft? Well, like you said, defensive tackle. If they're not going to bring Chris Jones back, they could also go linebacker. I think that's something that they need. They've lost linebackers over the years. One being a very popular one last year. Clark had a sensational year bringing him over from Seattle. He was a big part of their Super Bowl championship. But They need to add defensive help. That's where I think they go.
And the Broncos.
The Broncos, they have a rookie quarterback that looked sensational in the second half. He was one of the best rookie quarterbacks we've seen in a very long time. A guy that Mikey C. loved. He fell into the second round, and he thought he was the best quarterback in the draft. I beg to differ. I still think Daniel Jones is the best quarterback in the draft. Kyler Murray also looks sensational in certain aspects of his game as well. I do think that was a really bad quarterback class. This year, it's going to be a bad, even worse quarterback class.
Really?
Yes, I think this is...
I know you're down on Tua, but you think the whole class really is going to be disappointing?
I think
disappointing?
The class is bad. I think the class is bad, yeah.
I know you like Herbert, but you're down on everyone else.
I think Herbert is the best quarterback in this class. I think Burrows could be the best quarterback in this class. He's a good leader, but I don't know if his style of game, his body tone, and really his pocket presence, because that's what he is. He's a pocket quarterback. I don't know if it fits the NFL's culture anymore. I think these multi-dimensional quarterbacks are better. So I don't know if his style is going to fit in the NFL now moving forward. I think Herbert could do all different things. He's accurate. He's big. He's strong. He can move inside and out of the pocket. I think he fits better. So Denver, it's a good question, man. I think Melvin Gordon was a good pickup, but he has to stay healthy. Bringing in A.J. Boye, he's a good player. He's going to be their number one guy. And replacing Chris Harris is not an easy task. So is A.J. Boye better than Chris Harris? Well, he's going to have to prove it. Chris Harris has been one of the best corners in the league for the last 5 years. So Shelby Harris is a good defensive tackle. 1 year, $3.25 million. That was a good deal by them. Sam Martin, Nick Vennett. I think these are two guys that will fit to their culture. Question is, are they going to make the team after OTAs? I don't know. I don't know what this team... I don't care if you agree to a three-year deal in Sam Martin. If he's not good... That's $7 million. It's not a lot for a team. They can get rid of him very, very quick. So they're not big acquisitions. A.J. Boye, Graham Glasgow was a big pickup for them, and Melvin Gordon. Those are the big pickups. As far as I'm concerned, what they need to go is offensive line help. They lost their center this year. They added a center. They added different players to different teams. Really hand-me-downs to their offensive line. This was an offensive line that was very good for Locke last year. I was very surprised that they didn't offer more to McGovern. I was really surprised. McGovern was one of their best offensive linemen last year. He was a big part of Locke's growth. I was very surprised they didn't bring him back. Instead, he went to the Jets, and it's better for the Jets because he's with Sam Donald. So that's where I think they go. They could also add defensive line help because Von Miller is probably on his way out. So I do believe that's where they're going. Wolf is gone now. So I think they need to add offensive line help. So that's where I think they go. And corner. They can go corner too. So there you go. And that is our AFC and NFC West. What we thought in their free agency and what we think they should go, as far as I'm concerned, in the draft. So there you go. We're going to go to a quick break. When we come back, we're going to get into some more NBA, NFL, and yes, we're going to get into the MLB, and I've got more to say about our wonderful, wonderful commissioner and Rob Manfred and some of these new rule changes that we're hearing now here on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
It is the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.
You are such a fool. You know that? That's Speedy Petey, guys. A fool. As you know, this is... I still love you, Speedy, but you are a fool. 631-965-4990. The fool is sitting right next to me. Yes, Mr. Vibrator himself, a.k.a. Jellyfish Man, is sitting next to me. As you know... This is the Worldwide Sports Radio Network, and this is Down to the Wire. We are live every Monday and Tuesday on Down to the Wire from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. at night. Me and Speedy Petey, yes, the airster with the speedster, sitting right next to me, who is lost in translation, who does not know how to put on or wear a headset. Yes, that's Speedy Petey. And that, my friends, was Nirvana. Come as you are. As you guys know, we are huge, huge Nirvana fans. Anyways, I do want to get into baseball. But before we get into baseball, I want to finish up with some baseball. What was the story that we wanted to get into really, really in depth besides the basketball?
Well, it was all baseball. It was the spring training thing. It was the pitching thing and the home run derby.
Yeah, so we'll get into that first. But we'll get into that in a second. But first things first, we have a big fan, a guy that I highly respect who follows us throughout the country. He's from New Jersey, and he has interviewed a lot of big names in the last couple of days, and he keeps on ticking and keeps on rolling. You can check him out by going to his champagne, yes, his champagne Instagram, and looking, and he could give you all the information. Mr. Nithin, what's going on, my friend?
Hey, what's up, guys? And my Twitter also. Don't forget my Twitter. It's more for the Yankees.
There you go. Yeah, well, you can give that to all the people in a little while. But how are you, man? I see that you're interviewing a lot of people. You called me before the show. I like what you're doing. You're very, very smart, and I'll tell you why you're very, very smart. This is the perfect time right now where everybody's sitting home doing nothing to reach out to athletes, analysts, and all different people that are doing nothing. And why not give you an interview? And I think you've been very, very smart. And I love the interviews and all the different people that you interviewed.
Yeah, so, like, so this is, thank you for having me on. But dang it, Earl, so I'm going to mention your show today to Homer Bush. So just keep an eye on that. But yeah, so I mean, it's a good way to connect with people now with, during this tough situation, right? So
not one with words, that's for sure. But Nithin has interviewed Ed Reed this week. How was it like to interview a guy of that magnitude, one of the greatest safeties of all time, if not a top three safety?
Best coverage safety of all time.
That was an honor for him, for me to get talk to Ed Reed, one of the former, best defensive backs in the NFL, and he's a GOAT. So I feel like he's that was a great conversation I had with him.
He's one of them. And, he's one of them. I wouldn't say he's the GOAT. I think he's just like
the best coverage safety of all time.
Well, that's your opinion. That's not my opinion, but he was a great safety.
I had the opportunity to talk to Brandon Jacobs, Quinn Cash, Maurie Jones-Drew two times, and we were talking about like mock drafts and all pretty much.
Well, I'll tell you this, man. For a person that is,
and then today was Amanda from Boston Celtics, and then it was you. I interviewed also two times.
Yes,
and that was awesome. And then tomorrow got one. Thursday got a couple, and then Friday one so far.
Well, I'll tell you this. There's a lot of people in this business that do not reach out to people, aka Speedy Petey, who I've told over and over again over the last couple of months, reach out to different analysts and this. I know he's busy, and I know he has other things going on for us, and he does all the other work, but he needs to go out there and reach out to some of these people like you do. I think it's a great idea. I think you benefited from it. You've interviewed, like you said, Brandon Jacobs and Ed Reed and all the different guys and girls that you've interviewed that are in the business, that have been in the business, if not former athletes, analysts that are very well known in the business. I give you a lot of credit. And that's, to me, when you go out there and you put the time and effort into reaching out to these guys, you're going to get them to say yes. And I think the more you put yourself out there, the more people are going to get to know you. So I think you've done a lot of good for what people want to do and what people are trying to figure out and really get into while this COVID-19 is really taking over the world.
Yeah, thank you for that. Yeah, I really appreciate that. And it was a great opportunity for all of this to happen. And now we have to keep working at it at the same time, I'm trying to stay active. So,
well, again, you're doing the right thing. You have a podcast, and you can tell all the fans how they can reach you. But what did you think of Speedy's assessment of the AFC and NFC West? You could say it. Speedy's an idiot. Just say it one time with us. I, Nithin, think Speedy is an idiot.
You agree with most of the things I said.
Well, I do.
It wasn't yesterday.
I do agree with some of the things that you say, but you say it too much. I mean, you get too much into depth. You really sometimes. I mean, a segment goes for 40 minutes when it should only went 20 minutes. I mean, seriously, this has been a problem for me and you since we started this show. So, but I love you, Speedy, again. And plus, your vibrator is coming out very, very soon. And guys, you can buy them in stores. Again, I will post it up. I have actually the picture, the replica of the picture of what it's going to look like. You're going to go to Walmart and Target near you. All you have to do is we'll get the dates. We'll post it up on our website, and you can get an autograph signing vibrator from Speedy Petey.
You guys should tune into tomorrow with my interview with Rudy Reyes.
Absolutely. I know. Like I said, I know Rudy. Rudy follows us. He's a big fan of us. I like Rudy, and I follow Rudy's stuff. Rudy, you can mention us and tell Rudy I said what's up. I have a lot of respect for what he did and what he does. He was at Miami. He was at the Super Bowl. I had a rough time over there, but he had a very, very good time. I watched all his interviews, and I give him a lot of credit. He's put a lot of time in his podcast and put a lot of time in this business to get where he is. And you only envy guys that put their time and effort into it. And he just newly married too, Rudy. So nice guy. Very, very nice guy.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing to say over there, huh, Nathan?
No, I'm setting up for this Homer Bush.
All right. So. Well, Nathan, thank you for calling. I'll be tuning in with Homer Bush. Check out Nathan. How do they find you? How do they find the interview?
Oh, find me on first. I'm trying to upload the videos are still uploading, so it might take a while.
Well, how do they find the live coverage of Homer Bush tonight?
On Instagram Live, Champagne Yankee Fitness _, and then Twitter 214 Yankees, and that's pretty much it. And then I'm still uploading the videos, and hopefully by tonight or tomorrow, I will be posting it. So,
well, just so you guys know, Nathan has been interviewing Homer Bush, became very close with Homer Bush. Homer Bush has been on a 30 for 30 show. Between 5 and 10 years ago. And for what was the story? What was the 30 for 30? What was it about?
It's called Broke.
Yes, broke athletes, athletes that have made a lot of money over the years. Antoine Walker was in it. I remember it. Who made a lot of money? I think Antoine Walker made over $100 million, and he lost it from gambling and drugs and drinking. And so Homer Bush was on it, and he was one of the speakers on the show. Homer Bush is actually interviewing with Nathan tonight at 8 o'clock on his Instagram and his Twitter. So tune in. Homer Bush, who was an ex-New York Yankee, won a couple of championships with the New York Yankees in 96 and I think 97, if I'm not mistaken.
No,
98. So, it was 96 and 98. So he won a couple of championships with the Yankees and wasn't a superstar player, but he was a player that was a part of that team when they had, to me, the biggest and one of the greatest dynasties in professional sports of our era. So Homer Bush is a very well respectable guy, and I want to bring Homer Bush on this show very, very soon. Yeah. So whenever you get a chance to talk to him on the 30 for 30, get him on. Ask him if he would be interested in joining us on our show down to the wire.
Yeah, I will.
Yeah. All right, Nathan. Thank you very, very much.
Yeah, thank you. No problem.
Nathan, guys, you have to tune in to his show. It's like a podcast. He's on Instagram. You can check him out on I think it's Champagne something. Speedy, do me a favor. Find out what Nathan's Instagram is and his Twitter is so we can put it in one of the boxes so everybody can find out. So if you want to tune in and hear his interview live with Homer Bush. Like I said, he interviewed with Brandon Jacobs. He interviewed with Ed Reed this week. He's interviewed with a lot of people, so very productive. He's done a lot of productive things so far during this bad, bad time. So a shout-out to Nathan. But let's get into the baseball thing. And what was the story that I really wanted to get into when we came from break?
Well, there were three different stories. Did you want to get into the actual spring training thing? Because you were getting mad about Rob Manfred about something.
Well, let's get into the spring. We'll go through the Rob Manfred thing at the end of the show. I want to get into all the stories that you wanted to talk about. So what was the story that we wanted to talk about with the spring training?
So baseball has come out to say that there is going to be some level of spring training beginning in May, all in Arizona-based stadiums, all neutral Arizona-based stadiums.
Right.
and they're going to do spring training. They don't have a set date yet, but they project it likely to be something like May 14th or something like that.
Okay.
And a goal to start the regular season mid-May or late May to be able to do it like that. They haven't announced anything with the length of the schedule yet, but they said that seven-inning doubleheaders will be in effect, and obviously no fans. And the players are going to not be able to sit in the dugout. They actually have to sit in the stands to be able to do this too, which could make things interesting and delay it a lot. There's also some suggestions of doing the electronic umpire thing, which I know you've brought
up.
They
did that
times.
Last year in spring training. And they did it. They had it a couple of games this year before spring training was canceled with the COVID thing. I call it the COVID thing because I really don't want to talk about it anymore. But it's an interesting story, and I go over this over and over again with the major leagues. They're trying to change the wheel. And Rob Manfred, and I understand they're trying to figure out a time where they're going to bring back spring training so you can get the players back warmed up, the pitchers warmed up. Tanaka just flew back to Japan to take care of his family. You're telling Tanaka you flew all the way to Japan to come all the way back here with everything going on? That doesn't make any sense. I really think the baseball should not have another spring training. What I think they should do is pitchers and catchers should go back to Florida, go to Arizona, work their arms out, get warmed up. And the players, you know, there's batting cages. There's other things that players could do to get warmed up for the season. The season's only going to be 90 to 100 games. They're not going to play a lot of games. There's not going to be a lot of games this year. And I know spring training is going to be they're trying to draw people to watch it on TV. That's why they're not going to have fans in the dugouts. But I'm sure Rob Manfred and baseball are going to try to find a way to make money off the TV spring training games right. that they're going to be trying to put on.
Right, especially since people are going to be desperate to watch any kind of sports at this point.
Exactly. That's why I think that when you look at the big picture, Rob Manfred is going to try to find a way to make money any way you put it or any way you slice it or dice it. So I do think it's a good idea, but I also think, when is baseball going to start? When are they planning to start? Are they really planning to start July 4th? If they're planning to start July 4th, how many games are you going to be willing to play? Now, I understand baseball has said that they'll push the games all the way through November and the playoffs to start in November. If it starts in November, last November, I mean, it wasn't cold. I mean, I remember the coldest day in November was 35 degrees. It was one day in November. And it was practically...
I think that was later in November, though.
Yeah, but it was practically in the 50s and the 40s. It's still not baseball weather. It really isn't. And it could get cold. It could snow in November. It could affect a lot of playoff games. Mm-hmm. So, and then having the World Series in December, I mean, does that make sense? Before Christmas time? I mean, with baseball, with football going to January when the playoffs start at the end of December, January, and then you have basketball and hockey starting, I think it's just too much sports bunched together as one. It doesn't, and I understand everybody's going to say, well, we haven't had any sports for almost a month, so why not have all these sports going on at the same time so we have too much sports? I understand. There's never too much sports. But again, when you follow all these teams and you're an analyst or how about this, or you're just a big, huge fan, why do you want to watch why do you want to watch baseball, hockey, football, basketball? They try to transition it from one sport to the other sport to the other sport. And then all of a sudden, after that, you have college football. You have the four-game tournament in January and at the end of December. And then you have March Madness 2 or 3 months after that.
I mean, they're going to have that dilemma anyway, just with the way that their season ends right into football. The problem is, again, because it's later season football and more crucial NFL games and college football games, that's what could make it harder. Now, the thing is with baseball, they have their postseason games during the week, so I don't think it would be affected as much. But in terms of the viewership going that long, I mean, it's kind of a shortened season. Will it be forgotten about? Will it be prioritized? Another question.
And that's why I think Rob Manfred is trying to mix up the wheel. And I'm not going to say change the wheel because the wheel has already changed. In professional sports, go look at football. Go look at baseball. Go look at hockey. Go look at basketball. Every single rule, there's been changes with the game, the way it's played. Next thing you know it, they're going to raise the basketball hoops to 15 feet because basketball, it's easier for NBA players to jam the ball. So they want to change that. So who knows?
Point guard's dunking now.
Who knows? I mean, you have 5 foot four guys dunking the ball now, so maybe they raise the hoop. Who knows what the NBA is going to try to do?
Muggsy Bogues will make a comeback.
I don't know. I mean, with all these league-changing rules, it hasn't helped the league as much as they think it has. Now, in football, it made the game a little bit more faster, made the offense a little bit more better. But did it help the defense? Did it help the game and the schemes, the way the game is played? No, it hasn't. Mm-hmm. And in baseball, I mean, all these technology changes. What did these technology changes do for baseball? Well, it had teams like the Astros and the Boston Red Sox cheat. Mm-hmm. Now, we don't know if the Boston Red Sox have cheated, but there's some thought right now, the reason why Rob Manfred has not talked about the fact that the Red Sox are in the midst of maybe being suspended or a GM being suspended or maybe never get a job again.
Dombrowski's never going to – he's maybe already never, gone anyway, and he maybe probably never get a job again. He probably wouldn't have gotten a job anyway, but yeah.
But just think, well, Dombrowski was a part of that championship team, so he won.
Right, but he also overpaid for a lot of bad contracts.
That's fine, but he won a championship. But again, you have to look at these things, these different stories that you talk about. Sports goes all back and forth. It's like ping pong, okay? You could put a spin on the ball. It doesn't mean that you're going to get it over the net. It might hit the net. It might not go over the net. So, and if it does go over the net, it doesn't mean that somebody's not going to hit it back to you and ace you. So I think that when you look at sports as a whole and the way the rules are completely changed in the big picture, it doesn't help the game. It makes the game worse. So that's why I think this spring training thing, is it Rob Manfred's worse move that we've seen so far? No. Rob Manfred's made a lot of bad moves. A lot of bad moves. And that's why I think he's one of the worst commissioners in professional sports. And he's right up there. He's right up there with amongst the guys like Dana White or Roger Goodell. Because so, these are the guys. They're right there. What is the other story we're going to get into?
So that, as a result of this, now Justin Turner came out with a comment in this particular shortened season to avoid the wear and tear and toll on players' bodies if they do have to play a lengthened season, either a regular length season or a lot of doubleheaders. Instead of having longer extra inning games, do an NHL shootout type thing and do a home run derby after a 10th inning.
Here's what I'm going to tell Justin Turner, because he's a professional baseball player and he should only play professional baseball. That's the only thing he should be doing. Stop trying to change the wheel, trying to make the game even more different where it doesn't make any sense. Why would you have a home run derby? And I understand fans would love that and they can catch a lot of baseballs and you could put your best home run hitter against the other team's best home run hitter. What happens if one of these teams don't have a home run hitter?
Right.
How does that benefit them?
It's only going to benefit certain teams, and he's on a team that's the best, I think, talent-wise in baseball.
It doesn't benefit. There are a lot of teams in the major leagues that don't have a home run hitter. Mm-hmm. So how does it benefit those teams? There are teams right now. Right now, if you look at the Red Sox, who is their home run hitter? Who's their home run hitter?
Devers, probably.
No, JD Martinez.
If he's on, yeah.
Yeah, JD Martinez is their home run hitter.
Okay.
If you go up and down the league, Tampa, who's their home run hitter?
Tampa's is probably their third baseman, or their even Darno had a great year last year. They have a lot of more of the other types of hitters.
That's what I'm saying. There are some teams that you can't even name. The Yankees, you can't mention the Yankees. They got a lot. Right. They got a lot of home run hitters that can win. The Yankees will never lose. If the Yankees go to extra innings, overtime, whatever they want to call it, they would never lose. If they have Aaron Judge or Giancarlo Stanton or Gleyber Torres hitting home runs over the right field wall, a left field wall. That's not fair. That's an advantage. So, I again, Justin Turner should not be speaking. He should not try to change the wheel or change the game. Who cares about your legs? You're making millions and millions of dollars. We don't care about your legs, your hips, or your arms. Let the doctors worry about the million-dollar doctors that you have over there working for the organization or your doctor that you're paying tons and tons of money. Who cares about your knees and your ligaments? You're making a lot of money.
Right, and I also think players now are going to be subbed out more often than usual, and especially with the Dodgers with all the depth that they have on their team where they can manage it a lot more. Now, obviously, we don't know what the length of the season is going to be yet, and that's going to change a lot of how teams are managed, but a lot of those teams now, they're managed based on depth, and they will situationally do
things based on analytics, where you're not playing the whole game as much anymore because, again, the managers are being situational. And even Turner, who, again, used to be the best player on the Dodgers, probably 2015, 2016, in that lineup, best hitter, I should say, he's not really like that anymore now with other guys emerging. And obviously they got stardom now with Bellinger and Betts.
And I'll tell you this, and I understand that a lot of baseball fans, I'm a big baseball fan. There's a lot of big baseball fans that listen to us every single day. Shout out to Ryan Hickey, who's watching our feed right now. Great, great show. If you guys don't check out the Morning Boys, Ryan will fix your drop very, very soon. Ryan is the lead. He's the guy. He's our morning show. Very, very good show and talented, talented guy. And you can definitely check out a show on the Worldwide Sports Radio Network. Our app's going to be out soon. Again, he has a great, great show, and he really puts out great content. So definitely check out the Morning Boys. But I will tell you this. The leagues as a whole, and I understand that the owners want to make more and more money. They want more and more fans to be drawn to their sport. Here's the thing. The more you change the rules, the worse you make the sport. It's always been like that. It's always been like that. And I'll tell you this right now. Over the years, who likes football now? Or who liked football in the 80s and the 90s? You weren't alive for the 80s and the 90s. But I guarantee you, if you did a poll right now, I would say 60 to 62% would say old football, the grinding football, the 80s and 90s football, was a better time of football than it is today. Not the game as the speed of the game and the way the money has been made for football players, but really the game as a whole. Has it changed from the defense to the offensive style of games? It's changed. Mm-hmm. And not for the better, for the worse.
Again, the player types are a lot bigger, faster now, athletic types. But again, the rules really
for speedy
skew.
The line is bigger, faster, smaller.
Oh, God.
There you go.
Smaller players have gotten advantages now too, but also again, the rules really do skew it where it's really badly towards the offensive players, and a lot of corners, a lot of pass rushers really have had trouble again just making good coverage and good hits on a quarterback just because, oh no, you can't hit there, nope, you can't hold like this. They're so nitpicky now with the way it is now.
All right, Speedy, and what is the other subject we were going to get
into? The last one is also baseball related. The Yankees' new pitching coach, Matt Blake, says that as a result of this potentially shortened or, again, disproportionate type season, you're going to see more pitchers on major league rosters than you will ever see before. Now, they do have an extra roster space this year. It is a 26-man roster now, and they don't have the September call-ups anymore. But, again, he expects somewhere between 14 and 16 pitchers on a roster in comparison. Normally you see like 12 or 13. He expects that to be a new normal.
That's not new news. We all knew that was going to happen. Baseball is transitioning. And I'll tell you this right now. The starting pitcher is going to die. And what I mean by that is the league has changed and teams are changing. And the GMs are changing. They'd rather pay the top relief pitchers 3-year deals worth about $20 million than paying a starting pitcher a 7 or 8 year deal worth about $200-$300 million. So I think the league is transitioning, and I think this, what do they call this? When they start all the reliefs, what do they call
it? The openers.
The openers. Mm-hmm. So I think you're going to see a lot of that this year, especially that the season is going to be broken down to probably 100 or 110 games. I think you're going to see a lot of teams play the opener, and I do, because you don't have to press with your pitchers, your starting pitchers, and you don't want to wear your pitchers out, especially with a short season where you expect them, and everybody's going to say, well, they pitch 162 games. If they cut it down to 100, that's better for the starting pitcher. Not necessarily.
Now, you say the starting pitching is going to completely die out, but don't you also think to an extent that...
I'm not saying it's going to die out. I'm saying that owners and GMs are going to look at paying these pitchers that kind of money like... Like the Yankees paid Cole $326 million. I don't think the Yankees are going to want to pitch. I don't think any team is going to want to pitch a pitcher who's making every fifth day $38, $37 million.
That's fair. I also think, though, too, because of pitchers getting hurt more often. And also, there's not as many good pitchers anymore. There's just a lot of like average type pitchers. You still could use them to an extent, those types of ace type pitchers. Now, how it affects your salary cap, I don't know. The Yankees getting Gerrit Cole. Again, you don't normally see pitchers leave their team. Most top pitchers stay where they are for the most part. But again, in terms of the having that guy that could still churn out innings to give other guys rest, because again, they can only do this call-up stuff so much, more pitchers on a roster so much, because there is only 3 minor league call-ups a year, minor league options. So they can only do that so long. So I still think they are valuable to an extent. Maybe from a money standpoint, yeah, I don't think it will be. But in terms of the strategy of the game, it's still necessary to some extent to have at least maybe 2 guys.
So there you have it with Speedy Petey and his thoughts. And my thoughts with Rob Manfred's situation. Rob Manfred needs to stop trying to change the rules of the game. The game was built, and where the game is as a whole has been the game for 100 years. And I understand the league is trying to speed up the game and try to speed up the clock. And I understand you're not going to speed up the game the way they're trying to speed up the game. The way you need to speed up the game is try to get the batters in the box quicker. That's the secret. It's not the pitchers. It's the batters. It's the hitters. The hitters are standing out of the box, playing with their gloves, wiping their own ass, and then going into the box. I mean, it takes too long. It really drains the speed of the game.
Right.
And that's the secret. That's what baseball needs to do.
Right. And I also think they're trying to do with the 3-batter minimum, and they're only going to micromanage that more or just as much, depending on how your team is structured too. So you might have less changes as a whole in terms of the amount of pitchers used, but you're going to have changes more often, which isn't going to help in terms of trying to keep attention on the game either. So you have those kinds of instances you got to worry about. And again, with rosters developing into depth, you're still going to have a lot more changes than you have been in the past because of the way the analytics have taken over the game.
And that's it for our show, ladies and gentlemen. We will be back on Thursday, and our show will begin at 6 p.m., as you know, Below the Mic, which, guys, I want you guys to vote for Below the Mic. How do you do
that?
You go to rtfsportsnetwork.com, vote, and hit Below the Mic if you guys haven't voted yet. Vote every day. You can vote every day on every one of your tablets, your phones, your computers. We're up. Our show is up right now show of the month, Below the Mic, for 3 shows. And I will tell you guys this. We started 2 weeks late from all the other shows, and that's why we were behind. We had 0% 2 days ago. We're up to 25% in 2 days, 48 hours. The other two shows are at 43?
I think it was 42 and 33 or something like that.
Yeah, so we're catching up, and hopefully in the next 15 days we can catch up and possibly win. So vote for us, RTF Sports Network. Yes, rtfsportsnetwork.com. Hit vote, hit Below the Mic, and vote. Do that every day on all your tablets, phones, and iPads.
And also, within the devices, if you have multiple internet browsers, multiple social medias, you can click a link. You can do it like that, too, to get even more votes.
There you go. So thank you very, very much, everybody that's voted for us. I really appreciate you guys, and hoping to catch up and win. So I want to win. I want to beat these guys. I want to beat Twist, and I want to beat the other shows. I think we're capable. I think our show is just as good as theirs. Love those guys. They're great. Very talented, but I want to beat them. I want to win. So there you go. Shout out to Ryan Hickey. Shout out to Niffin. Shout out to everybody that listens to our show every single day. Tune in on Thursday, Below the Mic at 6 p.m. Yes, hopefully the show of the month on the RTF mm-hmm. Sports Radio Network. Hopefully we win. So we have a couple of days, 15 more days to try to catch up to the other teams or the other shows. Anyways, that's it for our show. This is Errol Marks and Speedy Petey, and Down to the Wire saying we will talk to you on Below the Mic on Thursday. Until then, this is Errol and Speedy. Good night.
You're listening to the Worldwide Sports Radio Network.